Gender plays a very important role in language. We see the influence of gender at every single step, at every single level, in the sense that beginning from sounds, words, and sentences, language is embedded and is part of both I language and E language. The kinds of distinction that we have been making throughout in understanding the categorization of language, also in terms of understanding the two significant aspects of language to deal with formal and functional properties of language. So, today we are going to look at the role of gender in language and an elaborate discussion on how it works from applied linguistics perspective. We have dealt with language and society and language and culture. We want to look at language and gender to develop a comprehensive understanding of these factors in understanding language as a social phenomena from applied linguistics perspectives, and also these things are going to help us to what language does and how language is viewed, what language does in society and how language is viewed in applied linguistics. So, to give you a quick review of what we are looking at is the view where language mirrors gendered perspective and can also impact and contribute the changing perception of people over a time is in the sense that language has, as we have established so far, is one of the most significant aspect of human communication. And not only it reflects reality of the society, but also the various functions, and it strengthens and maintains social existence. In such a context, that is language, gender plays a very significant role. How the simple construction of gender can all be looked at from its biological categorization based primarily on reproductive potential, and also the social elaboration of that biological categorization is what we are looking at in this discussion and is what is relevant for the role of gender in language in general, and role of how gender plays what kind of role for us to understand its applied linguistics perspective. Primarily, gender can be content of a sign, it can be associated with meaning, and it is embedded in a structure. When language shows embedding of gender in a structure, it is called grammatical gender, that is, it gets reflected in agreement pattern, one of the functional properties of language, which is at times not so visible. It also gets reflected in various ways when people talk, the tone, pitch, patterns, choice of vocabulary, pronunciation, and grammatical patterns reflect gender as well. So, with this introduction of gender, its categorization, and its role in constructing language from the gendered perspective is what we will be discussing in this unit. So, to do that, we have invited Dr. Pratha Chandra from IIT Delhi, and then we listened to her on her perspective on gender and how it plays a role in the study of language.
So, what I'll talk about today is gender in language. It's a topic which is much studied in the linguistic literature. However, much of the study has been conducted within the domains of applied linguistics, without taking the observations from theoretical linguistics. So, what I'm going to suggest today is that if some of the insights from theoretical linguistics are considered, we may be able to better explain how language is put to use, which I think is the primary object language of applied linguistics. I'll take language, therefore, at two different levels of analysis or representation, the I-language level, which is the grammatical level, and the E-language level, which is language where you have morphophonological representation, and therefore you are ready to use language. And I would assume that these two are related to each other. However, E-language has an extra dimension, which we call experience, which native speakers consciously effect to get the maximum benefit from communication. And therefore, I think that applied linguistics should study language use at both ends, at both levels. I-language is used for unconscious thought and cognition, and E-language is used for conscious, what we call thinking for speaking and thought, okay, or cognition. I'll start off with what we understand by I-language. I-language is internal language, internalized language, and this idea stems from Chomsky's work in the 1950s, but more specifically 1965 with the coming of Aspects. The idea was that humans are born with a genetic endowment for human language. This is to say that we all have a core grammatical machine when we are born, all native speakers of all languages, and it develops. It allows you to learn languages very quickly, effortlessly, in a very short span of time. So that core grammatical, we call it grammar machine, is what we call I-language now. Okay, so that's the grammar. This is a quote from Chomsky, 1995, which is the Black Book, Minimalist Program. The human brain provides an array of capacities that enter into use and understanding of language, which is called the language faculty. A common human endowment of the language faculty is the generative procedure, the grammar machine. And this we call the I-language. It's a pretty abstract level of representation where you have the rules that give you language. This I-language, the internal language structures, feed into the outputs that you have, feed into the semantics component. They give you semantics. It gives you what we call compositional semantics. And this in turn relate to thought and or thinking, the way we think about the world, for instance, and probably unconscious thinking that is related to the I-language structures. And here's an example of how our I-language structures or rules will give you semantics. So if you have John loves Mary, depending on the position of the noun phrase or the NP, you will have a different semantics for John. This will be experiencer. And this Mary over here will be, given the principles, the rules of word order in English, this will be the theme. But if you change the order, as you see in two, Mary now becomes the experiencer and John becomes the theme. Right? Okay, so somewhere I-language structures are giving you the semantics as well as the thought, the ability to think, because you have different thoughts. And there are also numerous studies, including those by Spelke 2004, who show that with the development of I-language, your cognitive skills also develop. So you have a cognitive jump when you have the ability to produce larger structures. For example, if you have long sentences or if you have what we call complex structures, embedded structures. For those of you who know enough of linguistics, we call that property recursion. So the more recursive structures you have, the ability, the cognitive ability goes up. So here's an example. You have X near the cylinder at the corner of the room. This X is an object, like any object. You can call it the camera, you can call it a table. So this X is modified by a prepositional phrase, let's call it PP. And you can see this X is near the cylinder, and then there are two more PPs, and each of the PPs at the corner, for instance, modifies cylinder. Of the room, another PP modifies corner. So there is a lot of structures in the XP. So it's a big complex noun phrase. Now it turns out that when kids as young as two and more, when they get these recursive structures, the ability to have larger structures, linguistic structures, more complex ones, they're also able to locate X, despite the fact that it's inside a large noun phrase. So somewhere they can locate it. And this contrasts with the behavior of trained mice who cannot locate something as complex as this. They can locate something like X near, if they're trained. They can locate something like X near the corner of the room. That amount, maybe at the corner. That's perfectly fine. But something as complex as this can be only done by human kids. There is a positive correlation between your linguistic ability and your cognitive ability. In contrast to I-language, we have E-language, which is the external language. External language is where we have morphophonological form. It has a form that can be used. I was talking about representations which we were using just for thought. You don't need to externalize it all the time. You also think in language, and that doesn't need to go for communication. External, by the way, is meant for communication. I mean, you can use it for communication. And Chomsky says these are the phonetic forms. So UG is universal grammar, but phonetic forms that have some representation and it's ready to use. And Chomsky, by the way, is very clear on making a distinction between E and I language. He says I language and E language are different levels of representation. Right, you would like to keep them separate. And here's another quote from the same book, 1995. He says, note that if e-languages do exist, they are at a considerably further remove from mechanisms and behavior of i-language. So Chomsky seems to be skeptical about giving a systemic analysis to e-language, which is used for communication, ultimately. I think because e-language is used for communication, and communication itself is extremely multifarious. It's very complex. It's a very complex phenomenon. You have multiple aspects to it. When a speaker uses language or when we speak, you have to take the speaker's experience, you have to take the speaker's intentions, you have to take socio-cultural, political, economic factors into account. Right? So it's a very complex phenomenon, and probably for that reason, Chomsky has not been very open to the idea of giving a systemic, like a very narrow definition of e-language. And so I think e-language then is more conducive for something like thinking for speaking in the sense of Slobin 1996. Thinking for speaking means that it's conscious. So because when you start speaking, when you start communicating, you are within the conscious realm of your mind, right? You use language to adjust with the society and also to benefit most from your social interactions. So when you communicate, you are already, you have enough control over what you do with language. Language then serves, along with your experience, as a tool for control, right? And also to understand the world better. So here is a quote from Slobin. He does not have something called IE language distinction. He just has language. He doesn't believe in I language, right? So I'm just going to add E language as meaning language for him, which is why you see I put it in italics. And he says, E language surely directs us to attend while speaking to the dimensions of experience that are enshrined in grammatical categories. So you have this extra dimension of experience that comes in when you have e-language. So what do we get from this intro, right? So we have i-language forms, which are abstract mental constructs. They are used internally for unconscious thought and cognition. E-language forms, as morphophonological constructs, are directed more towards conscious thinking for speaking and cognition. And e-language forms, we're going to assume, are manifestations, varied manifestations of underlying i-language forms. You have i-language forms, which we are going to take as universal, and e-language are manifestations. Their uses emerge from the differential experience they are enshrined in. Okay, so now if we have two levels of representation, i and e-language levels of representation, what I'm going to suggest now is that if we look at various categories, grammatical categories of human language, including gender, which I'm going to focus on today, we will see that each of these categories could be dealt with at two different levels, i-language and e-language. And e-language users are extremely varied. That is where you find cross-linguistic variation. So maybe if we have an idea of what goes into where, which category serves what function at which level of representation, applied linguistics may gain a lot from that. Okay, but before I go to gender, I'll very quickly touch upon color, which is a very popular topic. So let me touch on color a little bit and do the same exercise with it. By the way, there will be no definite answers in applied linguistic questions from my side. I'll leave it to the audience to ask these questions. Okay, so color, by the way, is a very contentious topic in the sense that you really don't have any definite answer to what color does and what's the representation. But it is a very widely studied topic which tries to relate. Most papers dealing with it deal with color to relate linguistic forms to cognitive ability, which most of you will know is also called the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, which is the idea that your language shapes thought. Right? It could be a completely deterministic approach that your language that you can think or you can see, perceive, idea, relativistic idea, where you're saying that your language helps in your thinking and your perception. Okay, so there is a lot, it's a very contentious topic, but one consensus, one thing we know is that there's a lot of cross-linguistic variation on color terms. The actual forms that you have, like red is a term, blue is a term, there's a lot of cross-linguistic variation. Some languages have as few as two color terms, black and white. Some languages have 11, some languages have 18 color terms. That's something we know because there has been a lot of typological study that has been done on color terms. The other idea that is mostly accepted in the literature is that the most common color terms that you find across languages are black or dark, white or light, red, blue, green, yellow, brown. These are some of the core colors. Okay. I mean, there is a lot of cross-linguistic variation, and people and researchers, mainly cognitive scientists, have recognized that despite these differences, despite the fact that some languages have color terms for some colors and some languages don't have them, when you actually present speakers with colors, when you turn them into experimental subjects, they essentially recognize the colors. So even if you don't have a color term for red in your language, you will recognize the color red if you're given a stimulus. Right? That's the idea. And so there are lots of studies. I've just included some of them over here. There are lots of them. But Berlin and Kay is one of the most famous studies, and also Lucy, by the way. And Berlin and Kay take this idea that we recognize colors despite the absence of color terms in our languages. They take this idea to propose something called the universal focal colors, which is basically a common cognitive basis for color terms and color memory for all languages. So you have this cognitive basis in your mind or in your brain that helps you recognize colors. And they also propose something called the color hierarchy for E forms. So the order of color forms that you find in languages, color terms, I'm not talking about abstract color perception, I'm talking about color terms here. So there's a hierarchy. For instance, all languages will have terms for black and white. And if a language contains three terms, then that term will be for red. If it has four terms, then that color will be green or yellow, only one of them. If it adds another term to that list, to that inventory, then it will be for green and yellow. So whatever is left from the previous one, if it's green for the fourth term, then it will be yellow, and so on and so forth, and you have all these other colors. But it's a universal core, and they also have a hierarchy as to how they get represented in their languages. So on one side, while we have Berlin and Kay, Lucy and some others suggesting that speakers can perceive colors despite the absence of color terms in their language, there are also many alternative studies that show that color cognition is differential, that if you have linguistic terms, it helps you recognize colors more easily. So this is this famous study by Rieger and Kay, 2009, who state that color naming and perception are shaped by both universal and color-specific forces. So you can see most colors, but if you have a very specific term, let's say very red or blood red, if you have a linguistic term for that in your language, you will be able to better perceive or quickly perceive that. So you don't need a conscious effort to do it. You'll probably be able to do it better than people who don't have that color term in their language. So what do we get then? Well, its colors are perceived by all. At the same time, color terms give an advantage in color perception. So if you have the E form, it's easier for you to perceive that. If you have to rephrase this whole thing into an IE language distinction, what do we have? Well, there are some universe underlying color I forms. We can call the cognitive basis the I form in all languages, which explains similar color cognition. So the contradiction that we found in color perception studies, on one side we have Lucy and Berlin and Kay, the other we have Rieger and Kay. So that contradiction gets solved once we recognize that there are two levels of colors. One is the I form level, which is the cognitive, universal cognitive basis for colors. And these underlying color I forms in all languages will explain similar color cognition. Then you have color E forms, which are manifestations of the color I forms, and they are cross-linguistic manifestations. So even if you have a cognitive basis, how they ultimately get represented, even if you have red, which shade of red will get represented into a morpheme in your language will vary from language to language. You may not actually have a word for red in your language. So once you have those color E forms, then and they get enshrined in experience, once speakers put their experience into it, then it can give us differential cognition. So the contradiction we found in color perception studies can be resolved if we get to that. Now, since I'm here for applied linguistics, here's a question. How would language pedagogues take this study into the classroom? Now, I don't have a definite answer, as I said, so I don't know. I'm just going to give away some tentative suggestions over here. So for instance, we know from existing studies that in English language classrooms, by the way, for first language learners, kids who know the language, who are learning the language as a first language, it is assumed that by 8-7, the 11 basic color terms of the language, black, white, red, green, yellow, blue, brown, purple, pink, orange, and gray, they are clearly in place. So the kids know them, seven-year-old children know this. Now, the teacher can then use these color terms to have or to manipulate, they can manipulate to learn further complex concepts. For instance, you could then put it somewhere here. You can say a red skirt. By the way, even these are pretty easy for a seven-year-old because they come pretty early. But if you had to make further complex structures, you could even try that. Here the color red is then used inside a noun phrase and it gives you an attributive adjective meaning. And here the red is part of the predicate, so it's a predicative adjective meaning. It's doing the same thing, by the way. Right, it's just that the structures are different. And in many languages, attributive and predicative uses have many, many differences, very interesting morphological differences as well. So English is pretty simple in that because you may feel that there's hardly any difference over here and they learn it quickly, but kids learning this language in English also have an advantage when they have these color terms. This is for the first language classroom. Okay. However, the question then will be, how do we teach the English color terms to second language learners of English? In languages where, for instance, you know, if you don't have those same color terms, how would you teach them? And again, since I don't have an answer, I'm just going to raise questions. Would some of these color terms come early and would the others come late? Because we've just assumed that there is a cognitive basis, there are I forms. Those I forms are more universal, so probably it's easier to get some color terms. And it turns out, by the way, that existing literature shows us that many of the color terms come pretty late. Color terms are much more difficult to come by in for second language or adult learners, for instance. So question would be, would some color terms come earlier, some would the others come late? And for those which are coming in a, you know, as they come along, would we find the Berlin and K color hierarchy play out a role there? So would you really see, let's say, black and white anyway would be there, so it will be probably you have to memorize those. But for something as difficult as magenta, how would you teach that color? Or, you know, if you have, I think there's a color like buff, for instance, how would you teach that, right? So, well, would you really have a color hierarchy play out there? So maybe some of the insights from theoretical insights from this kind of study could be taken to the language classroom as well. So gender, the category gender is more interesting, I think, because it already has two subcategories. So in color, we had to do experiments to get to the two levels of representation. In gender, we already have these two categories because you actually get to see them. So one is biological, which is much more abstract. It corresponds to the sexes, what we perceive, the masculine and the feminine, the male and the female distinction, which is there. Right? That's how we cognize the world, and that's how it's also represented in language. That's fine. But there's also a second subcategory called grammatical gender, which is not available in all languages, and which is an extension of biological gender to a domain where you don't find biological gender. So let's say if you have chair, and if you have a language where you are going to impose your biological properties, the feminine, masculine features onto a chair, right? So that will be called grammatical gender. And there's a lot of variation there. So we'll have to see which plays out where, which is an I-language property, I-language feature, which is an E-language feature. And then we'll also try to see if we can make something out of these studies for applied linguistics domain. So this, by the way, is very clear. English has biological gender. Right? So if you have a boy, we'll know it is masculine. It also gets reflected in your pronominal system, he, at least in the third person singular pronominal system. If you have girl, it's a she, that also gets reflected. English is what we call inflectionally a poor language. You don't have much inflection, so you really don't see a lot of variation. But we'll see how English speakers use gender to divide the world into specific sexes, right? We'll see that, despite the absence of grammatical gender. So anyway, so girl is feminine and you have she, for instance. However, when you move on to something like cat, table, chair, you see that English does not have grammatical gender. So cat will be minus feminine, right? Minus masculine, and plus neuter. Now neuter will be taken as a category where you have minus and minus. Minus feminine, minus masculine. None of them exist. And similarly, when you have table, chair, bread, tree, we really don't make a distinction in grammatical gender when we are speaking or using these lexical forms in English. And this you can see. You can say, I bought a big fat slice of bread and I ate it, which is the neuter pronominal. So you will not say, I bought a big slice of bread and I ate him. That will be very strange, right? You have to say it because it's inanimate. Where I mean a bread. This refers back to bread. Okay. Hindi also has biological gender that we know. We will say ladka, ladki. It gets reflected in morphological forms, in morphology also. And but it also has grammatical gender in contrast to English. So if you have cat, bread, chair, car, bus, and if you know Hindi, I can give you the words billi, roti, kursi. Car is gari, and bus will be, I guess, bus. Right? So this is feminine. This is feminine, huh? It has the properties of feminine. Cat, by the way, we also have a masculine, a separate word, morpheme for it, for the male cat. But bread, why would a roti be feminine, right? But language is like this. And it's the beauty of language that we still know these differences. Native speakers do know these differences. Well, for most of us, speaking Western Hindi, not Eastern Hindi. Feminine. When you have tree or house, you have something like pear, right? Also makan, and I think, so you will have pear gir gaya and bada makan. Okay, so this is masculine. This is grammatical gender, where we have taken the features, the biological sexes, or masculine, feminine features, and imposed them onto this domain, where you don't have the sexes coming out very clearly, the gender coming out very clearly. Okay. Grammatical, Hindi grammatical gender also has morphosyntactic implications. You can see it in the way we form the sentences. It has these repercussions. So for instance, if you say roti and you want to add an adjective moti, then it will be, it can't be mota roti. Fat, feminine, because you're taking the features of feminine, the bread, and putting it onto here. You can see the English counterpart will not have nothing like that. Now, yeah, and also, so this is within a noun phrase where you put the adjective and the end and you get this kind of a relation, agreement relation. Now, when you say maine roti, moti roti khai, here you have roti, which will give its feminine features to the verb, to the perfective verb, also to the adjective. So it's beyond the DP. If you consider this to be the DP, moti roti, then it's beyond the, I mean the noun phrase, then it's beyond this. You also see verbal agreement. You will not say maine moti roti khaya. Very bad structure, I think, for most of us. Okay? So you have semantic, you have morphosyntactic implications. Romance languages, languages like Spanish, Italian, French, they have a lot of grammatical gender as well. They have the biological gender for sure, which obviously is there in all languages, but they also have grammatical gender. I'll look at some of these examples where you will see that it's mostly biological gender, but we'll look at the morphemes very carefully. So when you say La Niña, you have the A as depicting the feminine one, right? And you see that a morphological replication here, La, on what we call the article, the, right? So it will get reflected there. So the feminine child. But the moment you say the masculine child, bacha, for instance, it will also get reflected in a different way. It will be El Niño. So you can look at these morphemes and keep them in mind, because in the next slide, I'll bring on grammatical gender. And the A and the O, it has to be kept in mind, at the back of your mind. A is feminine, O is masculine. And you also see this difference in the determiner or article constructions. Articles, we don't see that. We'll say, woh ladka, woh ladki. In Hindi or some of the other languages where you have grammatical gender, you will not see a difference there. But so romance has this added thing. La señora, the feminine woman, right? Again, A and A over here. El señor, the masculine man. Okay? Romance gender, very interestingly, and this is where we are going beyond biological gender, and we are looking at how we use grammatical gender using our own experience to create meanings. So we are at the dimension of language where we are using something like a grammatical concept, an I language concept, to give us extremely different varied meaning. So here, and I think this part is like amazing, at least the data, right? Okay, so we have romance gender triggers contrastive semantics. Contrastive semantics. Huh? You can see that here. This is Italian data taken from Ferrari 2005. Again, you can, as I told you, to keep in mind the O and the A. So you will see that everywhere, O, A, everywhere, right? And you're going to get contrastive semantics for this. And we'll see the varied range, the extremely varied range of meanings you will get in this language. So when you say ferramento, it is iron tool. And if you say ferramenta, it is hardware. And there is a count mass distinction, which is very strange. Why would gender category, which we have always taken to correspond to the sexes, give us a meaning which is completely beyond the grammar, beyond the biological gender meaning? So something else is happening in such languages where you have biological gender changed to grammatical gender, and you're using grammatical gender to generate meanings. So iron tool is count, you can count it. Hardware is mass, so that becomes feminine. Similarly, count mass distinction you can find in grain versus granola, sifted grains, right, where you can't count it. You also get a plus minus collective reading. Again, using the same gender morphology, O and R, crop and harvest. One is collective, the other is non-collective. Also, small big differences can be obtained from using the grammatical gender morphemes, right, the E forms. So you have buco and buca, so it's a small hole and a big hole. Mestolo, small ladle, mestola, big ladle. Again, the small big distinction. Another difference that you find here, semantics difference over here, is rankio and rankia, ration and the distribution of ration, and this will be concrete versus abstract. Okay? So what we have done in romance is take a gender morpheme or two gender morphemes to give us contrastive meaning, and this meaning is beyond the biological sexes. Okay. Now, in Bantu languages, we find a further distinctive semantics coming out from gender. Bantu languages also have biological gender. Male-female distinction is always there in all languages, as I've already referred to. Bantu languages use the grammatical gender markers to do something else. They create noun classes. So they're all their nouns are classified into classes. And often it's very arbitrary. One doesn't know what are the meanings, what are the reasons for why you classify one noun from the other noun. So if you have, let's say, five gender morphemes in Bantu languages, it's a cluster of languages, Bantu languages. So there are multiple languages. And even though they're concentrated in one population, not a small region, a huge area, you have multiple differences also. But this seems to be something that defines Bantu languages. You have this gender morpheme, five gender morphemes, and each gender morpheme too will refer or will be used on stems of particular classes. So gender A morpheme will be used for classes 1 and 2, gender B for 3 and 4, gender C for 5 and 6, D for 7 and 8, E for 9 and 10. Okay, and here are some examples from Kilega, which is a Bantu language. I think the same happens in Swahili, which I think we're more familiar with. We may have heard it before. So Kilega instances with different gender morphology and corresponding semantics depending on the noun classes are given here. So you can see mu and ba. These are, by the way, gender morphemes, right? Mu and ba used to give you the meaning difference. So it's the difference is with noun class. So within this noun class, you have a mu and ba gender morpheme that is giving you this contrast between one and two. I could have kept it as a separate one also, but this is within the one and two, right? Then you have three bodies and four bodies. You can see, again, you have gender morphology playing a role over here, right? So female and male. Linno, li and me, ki and bi, and this I think is a zero morpheme, right? So you can see for each of these classes, 1 and 2, 3 and 4, 5 and 6, 7, 8 and 9 and 10, you have different morphemes, gender morphemes. So it seems to be that gender is very sensitive to noun classes, and it's giving you contrastive meaning. Why would otherwise a plural chair differ from a plural body? There is a meaning difference for sure, but plural itself is a grammatical notion. So beyond the grammatical notion, what is the role? And it's not just Romance languages or Hindi or Bantu languages that show these differences. There are many other languages where grammatical gender is used to give us different meanings. So English, Dutch, and Russian are more like sticking to biological gender. So you see a masculine-feminine difference. By the way, this is semantics of gender, and this is the language. So these three languages have a masculine-feminine gender. Seems that they haven't gone beyond the biological gender. Swedish, by the way, has gone beyond the biological gender, so they have a new uter and a neuter. Uter is where you have plus feminine, plus masculine, which is positive for both the values. Okay? And here is neuter. Neuter means not having any of the values. So Swedish seems to be playing a little bit more than with the features, biological gender features, than English, Dutch, and Russian. Then look at Blackfoot, Cree, and Sinhala, where the semantics that you get from the gender morphology is animate, inanimate. So depending on whether something is animate or inanimate, you're going to play with gender morphology. Tiop, socially prominent. These are the meanings you will get from gender morphology. Socially prominent, non-prominent, part or whole. Right? So again, there's a contrast. Socially prominent, non-prominent, part or whole. Gender morphology will give you the difference. Imas gives you specific semantics from different case from different gender morphemes. Human, unspecified, female, even plant. Right? Okay, and then we have our own Khasi and Alam Black. which gives us gender morphology, gives us meaning like shape, mass, and dimension. So across languages where you have grammatical gender, you seem to be doing much more than just sticking to the biological sexes. You seem to go beyond it. So what do we have then if we want to again play around with gender category at both layers instead of just sticking to the grammatical layer or just sticking to the language that we speak? Right, so let's, if you use it as an IE language category, then gender seems to be an universal I form, and that will be biological, because that is anyway there. It is there to start off with, plus minus feminine or masculine. So maybe that's the default, and that is what, how we can recognize or find that in all languages. But the extension of biological gender to other nouns leading to grammatical gender is extremely varied in form and meaning. So the universal gender properties can then be extended, and then you start getting morphological forms in different languages. In some languages, they come out differently. In some languages, you don't play around with them. You just stick to the biological gender, just like English, Russian, and I think Dutch from the previous table. The question then is, how are e-language forms, the forms that you actually see when you have grammatical gender in languages, how are e-language forms of gender used for cognition and thinking for speaking? How do we use them? Do we use them consciously? And it turns out, again, from cognitive science literature, that gender, grammatical gender forms affect our cognition. So if you do have grammatical gender forms, so if you think of chair as a feminine thing, object, then probably you're going to extend that if you're asked consciously. Not necessarily all the time. I don't think I'll make a distinction between a tree and a chair if I'm thinking about them unconsciously. But if I'm asked to do it consciously, I will, right? So similarly, grammatical gender does affect. So I'll give you some examples to show you what I mean. Russian speakers, and remember, Russian was not playing around a lot with the features. It was just playing around with biological features. And yet you can see that when you're asked consciously to personify days of the week with masculine, feminine features, so there you're forced to. You don't have an E form, but you're forced to. It turns out that they will call Tuesday, and these are, by the way, given in English. Huh? So they will think that Monday, Tuesday, and Friday are masculine days. I wonder what that means, but they're probably going to give it specific masculine features. The Somvar, bahut achha gaya, and Shanivar, bahut lambi thi, right, in Hindi. I'm trying to have a counterpart in Hindi. The feminine days turn out to be Wednesday, Thursday, and Saturday, and I think somewhere Sunday is missing from here, and that's a day of rest. You don't do conscious thinking for speaking, right? So this it seems like you're really pushing yourself to have some kind of a gender feature on these kinds of days that doesn't have biological gender. Now, for languages like German and Spanish, where you do have grammatical gender, experiments were conducted by Konishi in 1993, so they were given English nouns, and they were asked to explain what the properties are. Here again, remember, when you're experimenting with subjects, you're mostly asking them to consciously think and give you answers. So it's conscious thought. So it turns out, so if you give a chair English chair to these speakers, Spanish speakers have the word for chair. The word for chair in their language is butaca, most probably, and that has feminine properties. So because their chair has feminine properties, when they're asked consciously to think about English chair, they're going to give you an English feminine properties for English. So it will be slender, maybe, or it will be small, like, so all features that are feminine. Assume it. I mean, if you just assume, these are kind of stereotypes also. Then German speakers, because their stool is their chair, it has masculine properties, they will extend those masculine properties to English chair. So again, you're consciously affecting or consciously influencing your I language forms onto something else, right? So, or your E language forms onto another language. Okay, so it seems then that depending on the E language forms, different languages consciously use the category for thinking, for speaking. So here is one, when we push any speaker, whether they have grammatical gender or not, they will definitely be able to do something with it. Even if they don't have E forms, they will try to divide the space before them into different genders. Now English, as I told you, does not play around a lot with grammatical gender. It does not have biological gender onto its inanimate nouns, for instance, or non-human nouns. So, however, English also uses lexical items and morphology for gender distinction a lot. And this is, by the way, very consciously done because you create morphology. Your morphology, your words, are a replication of your society, how your society works. So you have chairman, things that drive feminists crazy, chairman, right? Brotherhood, mankind, reflecting all of us. So even if it's a chairperson, and we have been saying, let's have a chairperson, right? I mean, we have done it to some extent, but you have to really make a conscious effort. But you can see these are the default forms, chairman, brotherhood, mankind, to reflect all of us. And you again see the world divided, or the world very clearly as a default masculine world. Then you have doctor, manager, professor, they all seem to be default, by default masculine, right? Which is why you have lady doctor, at least in Indian English. I got this data from not an Indian English source, so I think it's also found in other varieties of English. But a doctor by default is male, so you have to add lady doctor. A manager is by default a male occupation, right? So you have to add manageress. And then you have, which we often face, I'm sure many female faculty members face here, you have a doctor and a professor, but then they add this, they suffix this to you. Why? Right? Right, isn't it very common to have this next to your professor? So Professor Pritha Chandra, but this also goes many a times, at least in IIT Delhi. Right, so we know that it seems like this is the default, this is the added one. It's a kind of like added thing, anomaly. It should not have been there. Man is a primate, as if women are not. Right? When a student studies hard, he scores well. So what about the girl students? Right, so, but it's very strange. You have the biological genders. You're not playing around a lot with grammatical gender in English, and yet you see that there's a very conscious effort to divide the world according to the genders. Right? Very conscious effort. And that reflects in morphology. There is also a lot of stereotype creation. I think it's stereotypical. I mean, these are really stereotypes. Women are more likely to make finer distinctions in color terms or choose certain adjectives or unnecessary superlatives and euphemisms. Why are they unnecessary, first of all? I won't know. By the way, this is a very famous study, Luckow, 1975. And if you say unnecessary and you still have it in language, that's very strange. As a linguist, I think the unnecessary word itself is very unnecessary. But anyway, even if they're used by women, or even if they're unnecessary, I would question whether they're really used only by women. Adorable and divine, apparently only used by women, or mostly used by women. Hmm? So beautiful, where you extend the adjective. Right? Also, instead of die, which is like direct, practical, you're using passed away. It's the euphemism. You are going to use indirect ones. So it seems that we women, or depending on certain context, we are going to use these kinds of morphology, which men do not use. Why? Would be, of course, a question. Also, stereotypical perceptions regarding differential language use by males and females. Women talk more than men. Women are more assertive than men. Women break the rules of turn-taking less than men do. Maybe yes. And women use more standard forms than men. That last part may be true, depending on, again, the social status of women. There's a very famous study by Labov in New York stores, where they see that depending on which store is frequented by which class of women, you see a lot of formal use, like use of formal forms. So that may be true. However, very quickly as a detour, I'm going to talk about this a little bit more and then go directly to the IE language distinction, our main concern. Women talk more than men. There is this very interesting study done by Lee 2014 who shows otherwise. So he takes excerpts of conversation from desperate housewives, which I'm not very aware of, but I know that it's a television series shown on American TVs, right? Television, so on channels, American channels. And it has been running for many years, and there are all these female characters. The leading characters are all female. So what he does is take an excerpt of conversation, this is the one that I thought was very enjoyable. And there are two characters, I think, because I haven't seen this, so I really don't know if I'm getting it right, but I think Bree is the female one and Reverend Sykes is the male one. Right? So Bree is one of the housewives. And you just look at the size of the conversation for each of them and you will think twice before saying that women talk more than men. So Reverend Sykes says, "Thank you, Bree. It always brightens my day when you invite me to visit." And Bree's conversation utterance is restricted. "Bree, well, Reverend Sykes, I very much enjoy your company." Then Reverend Sykes says again, "As I do yours. So have you killed someone?" And then Bree says, "Excuse me?" Very short, right? And then look at the length of Reverend Sykes' utterance, right? And look at the amount of time he spends on all these things which we may think unnecessary. "I have always found the treats you prepare for my visits to be are a reliable indicator of your level of spiritual turmoil. The more exquisite the baked goods, the more anguished your soul. This is a hazelnut chocolate chip scone with currants." He knows a lot, right? So I ask again, "Have you killed someone?" just look at this, right? Here you see Reverend Sykes, here Reverend Sykes, here Reverend Sykes. Just a small indicator that it may be a stereotypical creation of our minds that women speak more. I don't think you can make a generalization. Depending on what the context is, you will have males or female taking turns to speak more, right? I'm speaking more now, but my next speaker will speak more, right? And he may be a male. Anyway, so just a small detour. So what happens then in languages like, so here was English where you didn't have grammatical gender, and you use a lot of category, the biological gender category, to differentiate the world into sexes. You also try to show that this is how male and female worlds are divided, which may or may not always be true. However, in languages like Urdu, Hindi, where grammatical gender distinctions abound, women's speech may have a more distinct identity or entity. It may have a more. And that also depends on the social context, not necessarily if women go out into, let's say, the professional world, where you anyway are very easily mixing up with men or from people from the other sexes, so it doesn't probably matter. But if you have a closed world, you may create a different identity, a linguistic identity. So here is this very famous work by Minol, 2009, who observes that in the 19th century Delhi, Lucknow, Hyderabad, when the parda system was prevalent, there were subtle gender roles and corresponding linguistic forms that came about, and this was called the Begamati Zuban or Women's Urdu. This were by women of that century, where women were not mixing out or going into the professional world. So they had a world of their own. And she shows that the Begamati Zuban language or women's Urdu had a lot of distinct characteristics. But as I'll tell you, it's more at the level of words and idioms, a lot of words. Many examples. So here, before we go to the examples, Minol 2009. In Begamati Zuban, women are not worried about whether the men think of them ladylike or not, since men are not party to the conversation. There are patterns of differential behavior among women, but the prevailing linguistic style is straightforward and highly colloquial. Another important reason for this is that women were not highly educated, and thus the flowery and polite phrases of Persianized Urdu did not enter their vocabulary. So this may be true of Begamati Zuban, but it's also true of many rural areas where women also have a world of their own. So if they create a world and they're not going out, they will probably have two varieties of language, one that they use with the outside world and one they use in the internal circle. So if you have that internal circle, it is bound to come about, a new identity. But I think that's true for any community, any group of people, not just women. But this one is interesting, okay. So I'll now go through the words, and you will see a lot of them are very interesting, and I don't know if they're used in Persianized Urdu. So you have Rasna, Basna, a woman who did not have to leave her home. And you will see they're all related to her survival tactics, to her uterus, to her children, right? To things that allow her, that give her prestige in a household, that defines her existence. They're all related to them. Rasna, Basna, a woman who did not have to leave her home. Nigori, a woman who without support or companionship. So someone who's not really good in their own world also. Then they would create all these different relations with other women beyond their blood ties. So if you change dupattas, stoles, then you would be called dupatta badalna bahin. If you shared ilaichi or cardamom, then you would be called ilaichi bahin. Zinaki ka rishta means that you have taken a wish together. So you're creating all these very interesting idioms that have their own specific meaning. Then quite a few of these idioms you will see are more to do with body parts that give them the power in the house. So you have kaleja thanda rahe, pet thanda rahe, meaning may your children be happy. Coke or mang se thanda rahe. Right? So coke is uterus. So thanda rahe, may you never become a widow. Teri man ka pet, stomach, thanda rahe, may your mother never lose you. So it's everything to do indirectly with someone else who really determines your status within the family. Also, a lot of curse words. I don't know if I can take many of them. Chulhe mein jai. Let me use a more appropriate one. Chulhe mein jai. Go to hell. Then you have dunya se ure, into the grave, drop dead. Jan har marne joga, worthy of death. And then, of course, kasbi, bazari, ghungru ki sharik, meaning dancing girl or street walker, who are not supposed to be good women. And then poor, nikattu, aate ki apa, incompetent, good for nothing. So you have quite a few curse words. Okay, so what do we have here then? Well, we see that in a community where you have biological gender plus also grammatical gender, you've already made a distinction. in the society, and the society seems to be already divided into the male-female groups very clearly. Not that, you know, women have not come out, but I'm talking about this place or this era where there was a very clear women's space and role. You would have grammatical gender E forms used for conscious thinking, for speaking, and you would create a new language of that, a new identity for the language. And then they seem to be mostly manipulated at the morphological level. So most of the things will come out at the word and the idioms level. I'm almost there. Okay, so question, how do we carry over this e-language information to our language teaching classroom? Okay, there is existing evidence that advanced or second or foreign language learners find it very difficult to learn grammatical gender in a target language. And that you can see if you try to teach a Bengali, an adult Bengali Hindi gender, right? Extremely difficult. And even if you have Eastern speakers of Hindi trying to learn grammatical gender. And then, so there are lots of studies that show that Groberg, 1971, for instance, shows one-third of morphological errors in written essays are those of gender errors made by advanced English learners of German. Very difficult to learn grammatical gender. Rogers, 1984, shows that gender errors in free compositions are numerous for advanced learners. Similarly, Rigolf, 1969, which is a previous work, shows that English learners of French, even after 7 years of tuition or schooling, which means explicit training, make frequent gender errors. So grammatical gender is much more difficult. So which means what? What do we understand from this? We understand that biological gender, the I language forms, the default plus minus masculine forms, comes naturally to speakers. They are there, so you probably don't have to teach them. Any learner will recognize that he is a male and she is a female. However, pedagogues, language pedagogues more specifically, need to develop pedagogical techniques for grammatical gender, which are e-language forms, with multiple cultural social cues to help the learner understand the complexity of this construct. So it's not simply a question of rote memorization. You just cannot take or make an inventory of words and say this is feminine, this is masculine. You have to imbibe or make the right cultural association with these words. That is very important. So which is where you have to make learning experience very important. Experience, social cultural experience as an integral part of your classrooms. So this is where we have, again, the IE language distinction. And I believe that somewhere this will tell us that theoretical linguistics, because we study language at an abstraction, as an abstract entity, may be useful to language pedagogues as well. So what have we learned very specifically? Well, categories should not be taken as unilayered simple constructs. So we just cannot assume that you're teaching tense or you're teaching gender or you're teaching time to a foreign language learner or a second language learner and you have to somehow have a method for that. You have to really look at which level are you considering. Is it the grammatical level, something that is already there for the learner to start with and you can manipulate that? Or is it at the e-language level where you have to make a conscious effort to have experience put into it? So I think for language pedagogues, for also for applied linguists in general, the multidimensional nature of every linguistic category and form should serve as the basis for that discipline and specifically for language pedagogy. Thank you.
A few of us are doing a project on gender and language, so this was very informative. So I was mainly thinking about the I-language, E-language distinction that you're making. You said that biological gender might be related to I-language because it seems universal. But isn't it possible that it's just because the male-female gender binary is a more universal cultural construct than other applications of gender? I mean, if you apply feminist or queer theory to this argument, it becomes a little problematic to say that the male-female biological binary is I-language, whereas the others are E-language, because the argument is that all of it is E-language, with some of them being more universal than the others.
Asking whether this may lead to a problem, specifically if you look at the world as it is now, instead of just a binary perception. Now, I'll tell you, even though I've used minus, plus minus for feminine, masculine, there is always a possibility. So these are features. This is not saying that this is what you see in the real world and that's what is there in your grammar. Your grammar will have only the features plus minus feminine, plus minus masculine. And you can have multiple combinations, permutations with them. So even in cases where you have plus feminine, plus masculine, you should be able to do that, right? So your language will allow you that possibility as an E form where a person or where a thing is considered to have both the sexes, right? just in case your society allows that. So Swedish is one of those languages which has, so biological gender doesn't mean exactly like male and female as seen in the society. That's a societal thing. All that I meant was that there are features, let's say there is a binary parameter for these features, but you can also have minus feminine, minus masculine, right? Which does not go with what we see, at least in the human world, right? We will think, oh, well, everyone should be either masculine or feminine, because that's the way society has constructed it. But when you look at it from an I language perspective, it tells you that your ability to think beyond the social constructs is much more, right? So at a time when we have, let's say, someone considered to have both the sexes, let's say plus feminine and minus feminine, will your I language give you the possibility, I language meaning your language, right? Will your I language give you the possibility to create new terms for a society where you don't just consider this binary opposition? You think there can be people who can have both sexes, right? Or who can behave like males and females alike. Would you allow that? I think your language gives you the possibility, which is where the immense power of language lies, right? You're saying that it's not just plus feminine or masculine. So binary opposition is not there in language. The opposition is created in the society. Your language gives you that permutation. By the way, when I talk about I language, grammar essentially is telling you you're dealing with very ideal constructs, very few primitives. Those primitives have multiple permutations. So even though I have said biological gender seems to be the primitive, it does not mean that biological gender is only either this or that. That's out there, right? Did I explain it?
Okay. Thank you.
I have two questions. First one is related to the color term, where you said that yes, even if we do not have that color term, we can recognize those colors. Very recent, and please correct me if I sound really naive or something, but very recently I came across an article which said that ancient classics and ancient articles, they didn't have color for, like, the color for ocean was dark, but not blue. So probably because they didn't have the term blue in their language, they didn't see that, okay, it is, and they didn't see that the ocean can be blue, and they termed it as dark. And for to check this, they recently went to Africa, where they do not have distinctions between green and blue. So they had all green colors and one blue, and they couldn't understand, okay, which one is blue. But when they had different shades of green, they could easily say, okay, this is a different shade. So then I think, again, coming to, I mean, if I read that article and if I hear today, like, all the scholars saying that even if it's not there, you can, so I don't know what is true, because if you do not have something, you can't see it. And my mom, like, she can't distinguish between, like, different shades of pink. She's like, everything is pink. So, like, what do you have to say on that, A? And second, where you give that example, the distinction between gender, like count and mass, so male and female, and small and big. That's just an observation. Like, what was interesting in that language was, like, small was for male and big was for female. Interestingly, in Hindi, small is for female and big is for male. So is it more of the society thing that they are giving importance to women? And okay.
By the way, I should say these are not naive questions. No questions are naive. Very thoughtful. First is the color perception. That you, if you have colored terms, it becomes easier for you to perceive them. In fact, you have to make a very conscious effort. As I told from the language pedagogical studies, people have found that in second language learning or foreign language learning, teaching color terms is often very difficult, specifically if those color terms are not there in your language. So you really can't find a correspondence. You see, even when we learn, let's say, any structure, so if you learn a relative clause, which is very similar to the relative clause structure of, let's say, the language you are learning, let's say English, and you're a Hindi speaker, it will be easier oftentimes to impose your grammatical constructs onto that. And we often do that. Sometimes we do a direct translation, which is not the right way to do grammatical teaching or learning. So color perception, as far as I understand, will be difficult if you don't have those color terms, which is what was mentioned here, that some of it is universal, some of it is not. So the universal part probably will be where you take dark also as meaning black. So you may not have a clear distinction between black and dark. Many languages may have a term for dark instead of black. And people may just assume that. So if it's black, people can say dark, right? So if something is black here and I can see the base of the PC here as black, it's dark also. So that itself is very interesting, which is why, if you remember the way the language, the color terms were put, it said black or dark. So if before they had the blue term, which was more attuned to something that they would take for, let's say, the English language, then they would have dark, because it is true that the ocean can be very dark. You may also be imposing some other features. Dark meaning something that does not bring you very, is not very auspicious, for instance, right? So they may have had a disaster. You know that ancient history also tells us many of the civilizations were done away with because of floods, huge floods, right? Maybe there were tsunamis. There could be multiple things. So dark could also be associated with culture-specific terms. Right? But the fact is that you will have a color term for, if you have only two color terms in any language, it will be black and white or dark and white. So these two colors are there to start off with. The second question was about the way you see the society will come into work. It will start functioning. Because as you rightly said, that if in romance, and in fact while I was writing these forms from this romance language, I realized that small hole is masculine and big hole is feminine. Right, a small something is masculine and big is feminine. So why is it that in Hindi, as you say, many a times we attribute smallness to female or feminine properties? And I think that is where society comes in, because the I language form will not be affected. In fact, when I look at you or when I look at a hole, whether it's a, you know, a small hole for a small cat to go through, remember the Eureka moment for, I forget which scientist, so he makes two holes. Archimedes, right? Yeah, so where he makes two holes, one for the big cat to go through and one for the small cat to go through, right? Without really thinking twice that even through the big hole, you could get the small cat go through. But anyway, that's a scientist thinking for you. And maybe there were no engineers. But what is interesting is that you really don't think of holes as feminine or masculine, right? However, when you live in a society and if you start using these features to gain more meaning, you know that you have to use that, then what you do is start constructing. So in these countries, like let's say Italy and Spain, I'm not sure if they're not patriarchal societies. They are patriarchal societies, but maybe there is more participation of women. So maybe they don't always attribute smallness to women. Right? That could also be it. I mean, one has to look at the socio-cultural aspects. Yeah, I agree. Or I mean, at some point I've heard that 17th century French men were pretty short. Right? So that could be also a part of it. I don't know. I don't have an answer to that.
We don't understand grammatical categories well enough to make any generalization at all. Not just gender or number or honor paradigms, even tense. The three forms or two forms of tense that we take for granted are not universally attested. And they have little to do with performance, you know. I mean, people, when they use English, people use English, or people use French, as in Francophile Africa, then given sufficient motivation and exposure, they learn. I'll come specifically one by one to. So for example, the color terms, you seem to have said that those who don't have terms for color have difficulty recognizing those colors. I can tell you from lots of data that those who have terms for colors also have difficulty recognizing those colors.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Uh-huh. Right? So it's not that, you know, performance is necessarily linked, mm-hmm. you know, I or E language is necessarily linked with I language. Mm-hmm. Okay? The so-called Hindi speakers, I do not know who they are, because mm-hmm. Hindi at the best is a link language. All kinds of people make all kinds of mistakes, even in Delhi, even with gender.
Right.
And there are any number of non-Hindi speakers who also write, mm-hmm. speak, you know, write and speak excellent Hindi. I'll give you the most celebrated example. The entire poems of Kabir were collected by somebody called Chitindra Mohan Sen, who, using your paradigm, was a Bengali, who didn't live ever in Agra or Delhi.
Mm-hmm.
But wrote, and you know, similarly the first grammars of Hindi, first grammars were not written by any so-called Hindi speaker. You know, these things don't have one-to-one correlation with exposure. We do not know. I can take individual examples. It is not that all, you know, the young lady over there said, and you seem to have agreed with her, that a small is feminine. Not necessarily. Anu is the smallest that we conceive of, and Anu is masculine. Anu chota hai, Anu choti nahi hai. Mm-hmm. Anu aap naam de sakte hain ladki ka,
mm-hmm.
Anu ladke ka bhi naam ho sakta hai. Hindi mein bhi, Bangla mein bhi, Rajasthan mein bhi, Himachal mein bhi, kahin bhi. A small hole is not necessarily feminine. Saap ka bill chota hai, choti nahi hai. Jabki saap ka bill, chuhe ka bill, bada chota hota hai. A month, sher ki month, sher ka month nahi kehte hain. You know, these things do not have, you know, our search for logic may be right, but it's not in the right direction. So for color terms, you know, you said, how do you teach these terms in English to those who don't have it in their mother tongue? Mm-hmm. There are many things in English which we do not have in our mother tongue, and we learn, because human mind is not constrained by etymology. You may have any number of words in all our languages come have a foreign origin. Mm-hmm. Actually, so much so that you at the end of it do not know what is native. It is just an attitude. To stop here, you know, I'll say that capacities of human mind are infinite. And our quest to generalize in terms of what we witness, no matter how much we witness, is, in my opinion, the product of misplaced enthusiasm. Okay. What we should attempt at, therefore, is both as a teacher and as a linguist, is number one, to have greater humility, mm-hmm. and number two, to have more data. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you. One is grammatical categories. We don't know much about them. I think that's something that we should not take away. I mean, in fact, there is a lot of data collection that has been done, and this is not just within the generative paradigm. It is also typologically done by people who are outside the generative paradigm, people who are not Chomskyans, so, you know, who are not theoretical linguists as such. A lot of data has been collected, a lot of data is being collected. That's one thing. In terms of just empirics, the other is not knowing much about grammatical category. I think there also we are wrong, because we do know whatever we know. We are definitely have a lot more to know, but we do know, for instance, it is true that Hopi, for instance, does not have past, future, and present distinction. It is true, right? There are languages which take proximal, and I had that in the slides, that languages that take distance, and Hopi is one of those languages, Blackfoot is one of those languages, which take distance as the criteria instead of time and time. Now the question is, could we somewhere, the work of theoretical linguistics, and this is where I think we should be open to theoretical linguistics, applied linguistics specifically should be open to theoretical linguists, is that, is it possible to attempt to put them together under a single syntactic or generative or I-language analysis, right? Which is what we did with gender also, or what I did with gender also, trying to bring them together. So that's one thing. We do know there has been a lot of study. People have been spending years, let's say, collecting data from American Indian languages. In fact, most of American linguistics, which may or may not be on the right track, I don't say that that is the best way to go. But including places like MIT have spent a lot of time, and the many universities in Canada, for instance, spend lots of time collecting data from the Native American languages, partly due to guilt, partly due to save their languages, right? And also partly because of theoretical interest. That's one thing. So we do know a lot about grammatical categories. We know a lot. We don't know about it entirely. We do know a lot. And from that knowing a lot, we can try to explain. We can use it. Second, e-language, not related. E-language depends on what you mean by e-language, which is why I gave that quote from Chomsky where he says that if e-languages exist at all, e-language, the simplest definition of you can give of e-language from our perspective is a morphophonological representation, something that has a form that you can use, right? After that, as I said, you have experience. And once you communicate and once you have experience, and experience can account for all of the things that Professor Chaudhary was adhering to, right? It's a much, much more complex phenomenon, which is why you want to put it beyond your I-language system. You don't want to call it grammar anymore, right? Which is where the other disciplines also come in. Sociology comes in, economics comes in to some extent, psychology very specifically comes in. Talking about Anu, you said that there are various ways of understanding, so smallness and bigness. I think a lot also goes back to etymology. So there are these exceptions also, right? Lots of exceptions. You will have a lot of exceptions. And by the way, when you have experience, and there is experience after every kilometer differential experience, you're also going to find a lot of variation in human language. So we have to take that into account. so that, you know, Sapka bill and other bills, if they're small or big, of course. You have, by the way, syntactically, any ka bill will be ka bill. So you say Sapka bill, or if you put a feminine or masculine, whatever be the possessor, it will always be ka bill, because you're taking the bill as a masculine. So the ka will show, it will not show as a key. So syntactically, you will see that there is a morphosyntactic variation, I mean morphosyntactic manifestation. But in terms of your experience, how you understand it, whether it's feminine, what the kind of semantics you attribute is beyond your e-language. I said that e-language is used for communication.